My name is Billy Perez. We're in iiWii Studios in Weehawken, New Jersey. We have a Focusrite studio console here, and I've been working with this desk for about 8 years now, and I love this console. It's a great console. This particular console is an amalgam of two desks, two iterations of the Focusrite consoles of the 10 that were made. This is console number 2 and console number 9. The number 9 revision of the Focusrite studio console was purchased by us from Bear Tracks Studios in New York. And unfortunately, in 2012, there was a hurricane in the New York area that forced Hudson River floodplain into this studio and completely flooded the console and our room and all of our equipment. And, you know, the worst case scenario for any studio owner or engineer. There's not any other recording console that's like it. So to see them just start to fall off is just something that we didn't want to see happen. It made sense to not let another one of these things just become parted out or completely non-existent. Based on a sonic level alone, we had to do a lot of auditioning of these modules and comparisons to you know, rack-mounted 110 modules that we had that we knew were in perfect working condition. If it's something that could be replaced or worked on, we've done it. And I'd say that anybody who owns a Focusrite console has done that, but fortunately none of those other people have had to hose one off. So as far as you know, a knowledge of what the console is supposed to sound like, I would say that I'm really close to that just because of what we had to go through to make sure that it was going to be what it should be in the end, as far as the way that it sounds. I was really excited to hear about the plugin. I was super excited to be even considered to be asked to test the plugin. First experience I had with it was working with some stereo stems that I had that were a bit stagnant, and being able to strap this plugin across all of my stereo stems was just a joy because it actually sounded like I was back in the studio where I recorded it. My first impression of the plugin when I pulled it up for the first time was how closely it felt to manipulating an actual Focusrite module. It's almost actual size when you use it. Personally, I enjoy being able to, you know, use something that's a little bit tangible feeling. Even if it's a piece of software, I want to feel like I'm moving it around and doing things to it. And I feel that this plugin, outside of the fact that it sounds really, really shockingly close to the hardware, it actually kind of feels like I'm using hardware in a way, or at least what would be close to using hardware in the software realm. So a lot went into making this feel and sound like the equipment that I've, you know, gotten used to using. I feel that when Focusrite set out to design the console, they wanted to create something that was sonically, would stand up to any other recording console in the world, but they wanted to make something that was different in its accessibility, whether it be to an engineer, a producer, or a musician, whoever is in the room making music. There's a straightforward, obvious, functional nature of the layout of the console, which allows you to free your headspace up to stay within the music and to stay within the realm of what it is that you're working on, which is extremely important to anybody in the room when a recording is being made. And that's very important to me as an engineer, to be able to quickly move with and keep up with the musicians that are in the room. This plugin basically has everything that you need, that you would find in a recording console, right there in one window, as far as your compressor section, gate section, filtering section that goes to compressors and gates, and the EQ section that's there, as well as some other really cool added features. And the THD function is really interesting for adding color to a sound. And when you're in stereo mode, the analog mode is probably what impressed me the most about the software. The reason for that is because you can hear it. Anybody that's had a lot of experience working with analog equipment will know that, you know, on a channel-to-channel basis with a recording console, there's going to be slight differences in tones or in the circuit or whatever it is. But that's actually something that, when working well, is pleasing, that random thing that's happening that we process even subconsciously is what music is all about. That's what makes us want to keep listening to a certain song. So to be able to do that with a piece of software, to be able to engage that analog mode that Brainworx has designed into this plugin is really cool, because you can have it or not have it. So, you know, you can hear the subtle differences in the left and right signal of a stereo track, or you can turn it off and just have a clean, perfect digital signal. So depending on, and you can mix and match these things throughout a session in your DAW, and you can create some really interesting character using a feature like that. And I think to have a plugin that's modeling an analog recording console to think about these kind of strange things that electronics do when there's lots of it, you know, is really smart and unique. And in this case, it's clearly been well thought through, and it's not gimmicky. It's subtle in the way that it's supposed to be. I think that people will find that the plugin is great for not only the practical uses that you'd have in your workflow, just being able to have it on a lot of tracks, pull things up, bank around the plugin as you can with the master section. For practical uses, just in your workflow, just turning in mixes, turning in, you know, edits and things like that, as well as just being a really powerful creative tool. Brainworx has done a great job at replicating the amount of gain amplification that the filters have. And there's a whole world of interesting things you can do with that that aren't practical. And I think that people will find that out fairly quickly when they start exploring that piece of software. A Focusrite module has an overload light. When that light goes off, it's not actually overloading. You have to really make it overload by really pushing it. So one of the pleasant surprises was the THD setting. So it's, you know, I could overload a plugin, but I have to do it on purpose. Much like on a Unreal 110 module, if you want to overload it, you have to do it on purpose. So I thought that was pretty cool, and I found it very useful on pretty much any source that would otherwise maybe sound bland at first. The way it's laid out, and the way that you have this continuous variable gain control, you can experiment with that. That's to me, having an interface like that lends itself really well to just trying things, which to me is really important. And you know, you don't know how something's going to sound if you just select, I want to just let me just try to boost 3.5K here. That might work, or it might not, or you might just be able to take a knob and go like this, and just listen. And that's when you discover new sounds.